This is the first Sunday of Lent, and it's a time of preparation and focus as we move towards Easter. And I have a confession to make, and that is that most of my life, I'd kind of joke about Lent. I'd say, you know, yeah, I'm going to give up charity, you know, something like that. I'm going to give up being nice. And Eileen would go, you can't give up what you don't have. You know? Come on now. So, I realized that, you know, my whole life, I thought I had a personality disorder, and I thought that I was just a bad person, and then I found out miraculously, like 48 or something, that I had ADHD, and I went, so it's not a spiritual problem, I'm just a little, you know, wacky, and I look at things strange, and part of being ADHD, just so you know, is that you start to focus on something, and then something else happens, and then you go there, and then, oh, really? And then boom, and pretty soon, you're going all over the place. And the other thing that happens in it, which is kind of a frustrating issue, is that those of us who have ADHD don't have any perspective. So everything seems of equal value. It made me think, I'm not diagnosing, you know, our president or anything, but within a 10-minute period, he tweeted about Obama going to Radio Shack and buying wiretapping gear and putting it in his hotel. And then the next one was all about the governor and how he really messed up the apprentice show. I was like, okay, those are two really big differences. But with ADHD, you don't really know. So big important issue and a little tiny petty issue that can get equal attention. I had a friend who struggled with this, who was a pastor of a church in Indianapolis, and he said, I'm really struggling with leadership of the church there. They're questioning whether I ought to be their pastor. I said, well, what's happening? Well, you know, I was on my way into the elder meeting, and somebody wanted to talk to me about something, so I started talking with them, and I missed the meeting. Then I went, yeah, you know, that's a leadership issue I can really relate to also. But, you know, the thing is, you don't know, was that just, that conversation was important, but is that also this important? And so we have these kind of issues. Now, the reason I'm telling you this is, I believe that we have spiritual ADHD as well. And it won't get diagnosed by a psychiatrist, and you can't just take a pill every 4 hours and try and push it back. But spiritual ADHD, we start losing perspective of what's important and what's not important, or something's petty and distracting or significant and really meaningful, and we can't really tell the difference, so we kind of look at all spiritual things equally, right? And the other thing is that we have a hard time staying focused on what matters, and we tend to drift off to every new glitzy little thing that comes along. And Lent, I think, is an opportunity that God's given us to treat our spiritual ADHD and to regain our focus and to regain a perspective of what matters and what may matter a lot less, okay? So that's what I want us to look at today. And the passage I want to draw us to is in Hebrews, towards the very back of the New Testament, chapter 1. And let me just read this. In the past, God spoke to our ancestors through the prophets at many times and in various ways. But in these days, He's spoken to us by His Son, whom He appointed heir of all things, and through whom He made the universe. The Son, Jesus, is the radiance of God's glory and the exact representation of His being, sustaining all things by His powerful word. After He provided purification for sins, He sat down at the right hand of the Majesty in heaven. So He became superior to the angels, as the name that He's inherited is superior to theirs. And about the Son, It says, your throne, O God, will last forever and ever, and righteousness will be the scepter of your kingdom. So pray with me. Lord, help us to see you in a new way today. Help us to see what really matters. And Lord, give us the courage to sometimes change our focus and reassess our priorities. To follow you. That's our prayer. That's our need today. In Jesus' name. Amen. Mm-hmm. Well, I've been a pastor way too long. And that was really cool a couple weeks ago when Chris and I switched positions. Like, Prince of the Pauper, okay, you're the lead pastor now, and I'll just help you, you know. So he called me up and said, you're preaching the next couple of weeks. I went, oh, okay, I'll help. So, but the thing is, I think that all the years I've been a pastor, there's always been some new thing that comes along. A new way of studying the Bible, a new way of doing ministry, a new way of reaching out to people, a new way of communicating the gospel. And it's really funny because over the years, decades even, you know, we've seen this kind of rise of these things that everybody is going to fix everything, and then it doesn't, and then something else and something else. And years ago, Randy Roll and I, when we used to do this radio program here on King 1090 called Everyday People, we were interviewing different people, and one of them was a pastor in Florida named James Kennedy. He was real famous, he was on TV all the time, and he had written a book called Evangelism Explosion that literally swept the country. I mean, we had people in our neighborhoods knocking on our door saying, well, if you were to die tonight, you know, what would you say, you know, when you get to heaven? You know, why would they let you in? We were just going to have dinner, you know. And, you know, but it really swept in. There were a couple of questions you'd ask people, and then whatever their answers were, you had a good response to get right back at them, you know. So we were talking with James Kennedy in this interview, and I asked him, you know, was that like a brilliant spiritual inspiration to you, and it changed the world and all those things? He said, well, you know, I think the Lord was in it when I came up with the idea, and then the marketing people took over, and it just became this huge thing. And then he said this, I don't remember the exact day when the Holy Spirit went out of it and it just became a program. Wow. He realized that's what happens. And there's no power in these programs or these new ideas and things like that. There's only power in Jesus. Mm-hmm. And there's only meaning and significance in our connection with Jesus. And in his birth and his life and his ministry and his death and his resurrection and his reign are all that matters. And it's easy to forget that and go, what are we going to do about this? What are we going to do about that? And we need to find a cure for that kind of spiritual ADD. Mm-hmm. Now, in the Gospel of Mark, chapter 1, it starts out with Jesus' ministry, and let me see if I can find that verse here. There's one verse that's really significant, I think, and I'm afraid to turn the pages because the Bible may shred on me. Okay, in verse 14. After John was put in prison, Jesus went into Galilee, proclaiming the good news of God. The time has come, he said. The kingdom of God is near. Repent and believe the good news. And as he walked along the Sea of Galilee, he saw Simon, his brother Andrew. They were fishermen. He said, come follow me. You know, in that little few words, Jesus himself tells us what matters. It's time. God's rule is here. God's presence and his power is here. Repent, change, you know, turn around, go the other way, repent, change, and believe the good news, and follow me. That's the whole thing for Christians. I mean, that basically is, okay, this is like spiritual Ritalin. Yeah, well, trust me, sometimes we need it. Spiritual Ritalin that says, here's what matters. Here is the focus. All these other things can be distractions. Some of them may be good distractions. Some may be unhealthy, but this is what matters. It's time. God's presence and power is here. Change. Turn around. And believe the good news. And follow me. If we got that, you know, the message of Jesus' first sermon, basically, that's it. We don't know any illustrations, they came later, but that was the basic message. If we got that, could you imagine how free we'd be from being distracted and missing out on what matters and all those things? How clear we would feel as we go towards our celebration of Easter? It could be an amazing thing for us. And this is what I want to have for me these next 40 days. I can't promise beyond 40 days is more than a month. These next 40 days. I want to see if I can focus on what Jesus is actually saying to us and calling us to and inviting us to. This is what it means to be a Christian. Now, I believe in change. I believe that most of you ought to change. You know, honestly, you know, to the extent that I know you, I may think you need to change more. You know, and you all know how much I got to change. But anybody here ever tried to make a change in their life?
Yeah.
Even a good one, a healthy change, or. You've got only four of you, really? I can't believe it. I'm in the wrong group. Okay, here we go. Boom. Yeah. Vince, you got it, man. Yeah, no, okay, so just saying you didn't put your hands up doesn't mean you ain't got to change. So here you go. So, okay, so you have to change. Have you ever found that really easy?
No.
No? All these years I've been begging you to change, and you saying it's more difficult than I'm making it sound? Wow. Tough.
That's hard.
Oh, man. You know what makes it so hard? The miniature clinic, big medical center, they had a motto. You know what their motto was? I got it written down. All of us on staff, all 900 people, are convinced that all change is experienced by all people as loss, and it's followed by anger. Maybe that's why it's so hard to change. Because even if we want to do a good change, a healthy change, we're motivated to do it, we start to do it and we start to feel like, oh, I miss the old way. I miss my old unhealthy ways, you know. And then, well, how come they're making us do this? And then pretty soon we get mad. Why do we have to change? Wow, and I think this happens in the church. Not this church, of course, you know, but you know, if you throw a rock and hit some other church, you know, it probably is happening there where they want to change, they want to grow, they want to do different things, and so they start to do it, and they feel the loss. Oh, we're losing what we had. And then pretty soon they're ticked off. And then the church is filled with angry people because they have to change. I tell you what, I'm dreading the week after Easter, man. Would you preach that week? You know, the thing is, it's like we've known since June when we heard the tractors are coming, the bulldozers are taking this place down, and the church is like poltergeist. You know, it's like every week something new goes out. It's falling away like a bad movie on us, and we're hoping we can make it, you know, to Easter. And so... And then every once in a while I get hit with, okay, we're changing, we're going to the new church, we're going to be up there in Greenwood, we're going to be sharing with these people, we had a nice time with them on Fat Tuesday, right? We met everybody and ate some good food together, and then I start going, oh, you know, I miss the old dance hall where we used to meet. That is a ticket booth in the back of that closet on the wall, you know, it's still there, I showed it to somebody today, and I miss, you know, I miss the kind of a funky building, but that's where the glass ball came down with the mirrors on it, and they hit it with lights, and it spun the cool dance hall. I miss it. You know, I'm really mad that they sold that place. I'm really angry that we had to go ahead. And why do we have to be with the Lutherans? You know, I mean, my golly. You know? I mean, I'm just saying, you know. And it happens in little ways, in big ways, in little ways. Have you ever been with someone who tried to stop smoking? I mean, that goes without saying. Well, if it goes without saying, I shouldn't say it probably. But, you know, the thing is that somebody stops when they want to. They'll be better. They'll be healthy. They might live a little longer. And then they won't drink. All these different things, you know. And so they're going to stop smoking. And then pretty soon, there's a loss. Oh, you know, the way you kind of hit the back. And then you take it and you kind of, you know, and then you're like. And it says, well, I miss that. How come they're making me stop? That's crazy. I was happy. Why don't they just leave? You know, and then. Our family's been on the journey of addiction issues for, way too long. And I realized every time you change, you have to give something up. Repentance is when you have to stop and turn around and go another way. You know, but I invested all that time in this other way. I have to stop that, turn, go another direction. It's hard. It's hard. I think Jesus knew it was hard. He knew it was difficult. He knew that we would start to change and then we'd feel lost and then we'd get angry, and he knew it. And that's why that's his first message when he starts his ministry. It's time. God's power is here. His presence is here. It's time to change. Believe the good news. Follow me. You know, I've spent a lifetime counseling people who have been in the church for a long time, and been Christians or anything, and something happens and some change occurs, and they don't know if there's a God after all, and right, or why is church like that, you know, and everything. I can't tell how many people feel a loss and anger about something that's going on in their life every day. No wonder life's so hard. If you're feeling like you're losing and you're mad about it and you got to change, and even if you want to do the change, it's still hard to do. It's easy to wander away. It is so easy to wander away or just follow the distractions, see where they take us, or just pull back a little bit, because you know you get power when you pull back and back off. And when that happens, what is it that God wants to tell us? What does he want to tell you? My verse for Lent this year, I put that little ribbon in it. Expect to find the ribbon. Joel chapter 2. Even now, declares the Lord, return to me with all your heart. Come back to me with all your heart. Fasting, weeping, and mourning. Rend your heart, not your garments. Return to the Lord your God. Why? For he is gracious and compassionate, slow to anger and abounding in love. And he'll relent from sending calamity. Who knows? He may turn and have pity and leave behind a blessing. I think it's time to return to the Lord with all our heart. Not just with the religious side, not just with the churchy side, not just, you know, a couple hours a week or something like that, but with all of our heart, return to the Lord. Because he invites us to come home. He invites us into his presence. Not to get the whooping we might deserve, but with compassion, love, understanding, and who knows? I love that Joel says, and who knows? Maybe he'll leave a blessing. He might even get blessed in the process. Who knows? We know. I want to invite you, and you know, whatever your situation, whether you've been a Christian for 1,000 years, probably a lot, you know. Somebody asked me if I want to be 18 again. I said, I want to be 62, man. That would be so good. But wherever it is that we're going through, whatever it is that we're struggling with or hope to do or need to have happen in our life, that we would say, okay, I'm going to return to the Lord. It's time to come home. And in this season leading up to Easter, we can hear Jesus' invitation, come to me. If you're tired and overburdened, I'll give you rest. Follow me. Believe the good news. It doesn't mean that in the changes we're not going to feel loss and madness, okay? Get a little angry. But it does mean that the invitation is open, the door is open. And Jesus himself is inviting you to return. I think there's no better way to start our Lenten season than that first Sunday of Lent to celebrate communion together. Because really, this sacrament is a reminder of Jesus' invitation to come home. A call to set aside all the distractions and let him be Lord of all. Didn't we sing that this morning? Let me check with the band. Didn't we sing that this morning?
Yeah.
Christ alone. And that's what we do when we come to communion. So this morning, at Jesus' instruction, we're going to do the least religious thing that ever could be done. And I know it's kind of confusing to say that, but this is not about religion and it's not about ritual or anything like that. This is about receiving God's gift to you of his life and his love and his power and his compassion into your life and his forgiveness and his resurrection power. All of that, to receive that into you. And just like you eat a meal and it goes, Tuesday night, we ate a fat Tuesday meal, and it becomes part of us, you know? And it nourishes us and it strengthens us and it becomes who we are. That's what happens. But we remember that on the night he was betrayed, he took the bread and he broke it. And he said, this bread is my body broken for you, torn apart for you. Take it and eat. And the same way he took the cup and he gave thanks and he said, this cup is the new covenant, the new promise, the commitment God made. My blood for the forgiveness of sins. Take it and drink. Then he said, as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim my death until I come again. So pray with me. Lord Jesus, we hear your invitation to repent, believe the good news and follow you. We hear the call to return to you with all of our hearts. Not to hold back, not to be distracted, not to lose sight of what's most valuable. We know that you are Lord of all, Christ alone. So today, now, this time, we pray that you would take these common elements, make them uncommon with your grace, and that you would come into our lives anew, for the first time, for the 100th time, that you'd come into our minds and our hearts, our emotions, our issues, our relationships, our work. You bring your healing, your forgiveness, and your power. There's nothing we need more than you today. So we thank you for this gift. We thank you for your life, your death, and your eternal life. And we claim it in Jesus' name.